Good morning, everyone. We want to welcome you this morning to our Hymnody Sunday. We're so glad that you're joining us, whether you're here with us in the sanctuary in person or watching with us online. We are so glad you're here. My name is Adam. I'm one of the pastors on staff. We are so excited to welcome you today. If you are a guest with us, we want to say a special word of welcome to you. Thank you for being here with us. There in front of you in your pew, you can find a connection card that we would love for you to fill out and drop in the offering plate as it goes around. We also want to invite you at the end of our service, all of our guests, if you will go out the back sanctuary doors and to the left, there's a welcome table there. We would love to greet you and thank you for being with us. As we mentioned, this service is being live streamed on Facebook, and so one of the things you can do to help us is if you are on Facebook to take just a moment, whether you're watching online or here in person, to share that on your Facebook page as a way of inviting your friends and family to join in worship with us. As you came in today, you should have received a worship guide. Just a few quick announcements we want to mention in there before we get started. The first one is the farewell blessing that we will have next Sunday, August 4th at 5 p.m. To celebrate the ministries of three of our music staff, Noel Weaver, Aaron Weaver, and Mark Benz. And so come out and join us for that time of celebration, and there will be some light refreshments there as well. Secondly, we are planning some family movie nights for the fall. This is kind of a follow-up to Vacation Bible School, and so we're going to be watching the whole Toy Story series through the fall, once each in August, September, October, November. And so go ahead and mark your calendars for those, and then check our Facebook pages. We'll be setting up events there that have more details about time, location, and different things like that. Last but not least, you do notice the votive on our altar this morning, which is in loving memory of Davis Gray, who passed on Wednesday. And so you can see there the announcements about the arrangements for that, which is tomorrow. And we do want to invite you to keep his wife Nancy and his daughter Maria and their family in your prayers during this time. Again, thank you for worshiping with us this morning. Those are all the announcements we have. Let's prepare our hearts for worship together with our opening prelude.
Thank you. Please stand for the call to worship. These are John Wesley's directions for singing, so y'all listen up. Number one, learn these tunes before you learn any others. Afterwards, learn as many as you please.
Two, sing them exactly as they are printed here, without altering or amending them at all. And if you have learned to sing them otherwise, unlearn it as soon as you can.
Number three, sing all. See that you join with the congregation as frequently as you can. Let not a slight degree of weakness or weariness hinder you. If it is a cross to you, take it up and you will find a blessing.
Four, sing lustily and with good courage. Beware of singing as if you were half dead or half asleep, but lift up your voice with strength. Be no more afraid of your voice now, nor more ashamed of its being heard than when you sang the songs of Satan.
Number five, sing modestly. Do not bawl so as to be heard above or distinct from the rest of the congregation, that you may not destroy the harmony, but strive to unite your voices together so as to make one clear, melodious sound.
Six, sing in time. Whatever time is sung, be sure to keep with it. Do not run before nor stay behind it, but attend closely to the leading voices and move therewith as exactly as you can. And take care you sing not too slow. This drawling way naturally steals on us, all of us who are lazy, and it is high time to drive it out from among us and sing all our tunes just as quick as we did at first.
Number seven, above all, sing spiritually. Have an eye to God in every word you sing. Aim at pleasing Him more than yourself or any other creature. In order to do this, attend strictly to the sense of what you sing and see that your heart is not carried away with the sound, but offered to God continually. So shall your singing be such as the Lord will approve of here and reward when He cometh into the clouds of heaven.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Would you please join me in the responsive Psalter that is listed there in your worship guide, Psalm 147. Your responses are there in bold. Praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant and fitting to praise Him. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars and calls them each by name. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. His understanding has no limit. The Lord sustains the humble, but casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with grateful praise. Make music to our God on the harp.
Thank you.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer together. God, we thank you for the opportunity to just be able to come together as a church family and celebrate and worship and sing hymns of praise this morning. God, we pray that your Spirit would continue to stir in us a spirit of gratitude and thanksgiving that would overflow in our lives to all kinds of different expressions of praise. Whether we praise you in song, or praise you in how we love and serve others, or praise you in words of encouragement and support that we're able to speak to one another, we pray, God, that our whole lives would be an act of love and worship to you. God, we do lift up to you today all the different needs that are on our hearts. We think especially of those who are sick that we know today, God, that we just pray your healing touch upon them, that you would give them the comfort and the strength that they need. Lord, we pray for those in our church family who are grieving today. Lord, we know that you are near to the brokenhearted, and you save those who are crushed in spirit. Jesus, wrap your arms of love around them and give them your peace today. Lord, we pray for all the different things going on in our world today, violence and war and conflict and disagreement and division, all the things that we wake up and hear about on the news each day. Lord, in the midst of all this, we ask that you would empower us by your Spirit to be instruments of your peace and your love in the world. And Lord, we do pray for your comfort and your peace for all of those hurting and broken places in our world. Lord, as we continue to worship together, we ask that you would unite our spirits with your Spirit. Bind our hearts together with your love as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Standing on the promises, standing on the promises, standing on the promises.
We will continue to worship this morning by giving of our tithes and offerings. We'll invite our ushers to come forward at this time. We also want to remind you, especially those of you who are watching online, that there are other ways that you can give by text, by mail, or directly on our website. So let's honor God with our gifts today.
Thank you.
God, we thank you today for all the blessings you poured out upon us. And we ask that you would continue to bless us, that we might be a blessing to the people and the world around us. Lord, bless these, our tithes and our offerings, that they would be used for your kingdom and your glory. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Our first scripture reading, a reading from Paul's letter to the Colossians. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if one of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through songs, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. A reading from Ephesians. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I'm very aware as a pastor that I'm standing up to start my sermon at 9:20, and the fear and trepidation that strikes in the hearts of congregations everywhere. As best captured by the words of my own children, this better be short. And so it will be. Today we are wrapping up our sermon series, Kids Say the Darndest Things. And if you've been with us over the last month, you know that each week we've been focusing on actual questions that this year's confirmation students asked in the journey of our weeks together. And if you've been with us through the whole series, you know that we've been so blessed by their curiosity and just being invited into their discussions. This week's question is one that I would classify as a real humdinger. And so I hope you're excited to hear it. They asked, I think it was the third or fourth week, Pastor Adam, how good do you have to be to go to heaven? And how bad do you have to be to go to hell? To get us started, I want to point out that this question implies kind of a balance sheet mentality of salvation. And it really turns God into some kind of cosmic mathematician, right? That God would add up all the good that you've done in your life, and then God would subtract from it all the evil you've done in your life. And if you're in the black, if the good outweighs the bad, then you're good. But boy, if you're in the red, if the bad outweighs the good, then you're in trouble. And I just want to call our attention to something. Father Richard Rohr, I've been so fascinated by this idea. He rightly points out that as you read through the narrative of Scripture, it actually seems like we serve a God who's really bad at math when you look at it. Now, before I get all kinds of hate email, I'm not saying that God's really bad at math. I'm sure God's perfectly good at geometry and calculus. But I'm just saying that when you read through Scripture, things don't always balance out the way you would expect in the economy of God's kingdom. And I just want to give you a couple of short examples. The first one is in Luke 18. Jesus tells the story of a Pharisee and a tax collector. It says, the Pharisee stood by himself and prayed, God, I thank you that I'm not like all these other people, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all I get. Mathematically, this was a very holy man. He had devoted his entire life to serving God. He was obedient to God's laws. He fasted twice a week. He gave 10%. From the outside looking in, this was the holy person. This is the person who would have the balance sheet that would impress God. This is the one that if you had to place bets, you would say, this is the guy who's going to go to heaven. The other person in the story was the tax collector. You've heard us talk about before, these were some of the most hated people in society. Some of you would argue maybe they still are. But especially in Jesus' day, these folks were seen as traitors and cheats. The tax collector in the story, it says, stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven. He beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. From the world's perspective, this man was deeply in the red. And yet, really, Jesus turns things upside down here. He says, I tell you, this man, the tax collector, rather than the other, went home justified before God. All those who exalt themselves will be humbled. Those who humble themselves will be exalted. It causes us to pause and ask, what kind of math is Jesus doing? That the seemingly holy person is rejected, while the known sinner is justified. Or as a second quick example, you look at the example of the thief on the cross. The math really doesn't get much worse than this in the entire New Testament. Here he is, a convicted criminal, literally hanging on the cross for his crimes. He confesses in his own words, Luke 23:41, he says, we are being punished justly. We are getting what our deeds deserve. And yet when he says to Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom, Jesus turns to him and says, today you will be with me in paradise. Now we've imagined before as a congregation the confusion that must have erupted in heaven when this guy showed up, right? That there must have been some kind of scuffle to say, what's he doing here? He doesn't deserve to be here. And Pastor Alistair Begg famously said the thief on the cross had no other basis for being there except the man on the middle cross said he could come. Is it really bad math, or is something else going on? And that brings us to our scripture reading today. Paul puts forth very clearly for us that we do not believe we are saved on the basis of being good enough to deserve it, on the basis of working hard enough to earn it. It's not about scoring enough points to tip the scales. We are saved on the basis of grace through faith. Paul says, it is by grace you have been saved, not from yourselves. This is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. And this is actually amazing for the Apostle Paul to say, because if his life were a balance sheet, he had a lot that he could boast about in the plus side of that column. Paul had the religion, he had the pedigree, he had the education, he had the zeal, he had the righteousness. The list goes on and on. And yet in Philippians 3, 7 through 9, he says, whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I've lost all things. If that wasn't enough, he goes on. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. Now we have to be sure here, right, to include the caveat that we don't believe that doing good works doesn't matter. On the contrary, like our scripture says, we are created in Christ Jesus for good works. But we have to make sure we don't get the cart before the horse. We believe that those good works flow naturally out of a real and genuine faith. Now, if we really believe everything I've said up to this point, then we have to start asking a different question. The question is not, how good do you have to be to go to heaven? How bad do you have to be to go to hell? I really think that student was asking, how much can I get by with? Right, and still get in by the skin of my teeth. The question is really, do you know Jesus Christ? We have to ask ourselves the same hard questions. There was a guy by the name of August Spangenberg, a Moravian leader, who asked John Wesley just some really probing questions before his famous Aldersgate Street experience, and Wesley wrote those in his journal. He asked Wesley, do you know yourself? Do you have the witness within yourself? Does the Spirit of God bear witness with your spirit that you're a child of God? He pressed him further, do you know Jesus Christ? Do you know he has saved you? And my prayer for us today is that we would be able to say with Wesley, I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt that I did trust in Christ, Christ alone for salvation, and an assurance was given me that he was taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. So to close us today and to move us into our last songs together, I just want to remind us, God may be really bad at math, but God's amazing at grace. And that's the thing that we're really here celebrating today. That's the thing that we're gathered together to sing about. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Let me pray for us before we sing our last song together. Let's pray. God, we thank you that in our own lives, that you are not the meticulous mathematician. You are not weighing unfairly. You are not a God of counting and measuring and scrupulously keeping every little detail in a way to just damn us. But we see over and over again in Scripture, not that you're really bad at math, but God, sometimes the economy of your kingdom makes no sense to us. And we thank you, God. We give gratitude to you that this is not all about us being good enough to deserve something. It's not all about us working hard enough to earn it, but that we have been given a gift of grace. Lord, we pray that we would receive your love and your grace into our hearts and our lives, that we would surrender ourselves to following you, Jesus. And we pray that that love and grace would work in us and through us, that your good works would flow out of us into how we bless others and how we care for your people and your world. So, Lord, bless us together as we end this service, that we truly would celebrate and sing about your amazing grace. We pray all these things in Christ's name, and all God's people said. Amen.
Thank you.
We want to thank you again for worshiping with us today. Remember, if you're a guest with us, if you go out the back sanctuary doors and to the left, there's a welcome table there. We would love to greet you. We do want to take just a moment to thank all of our musicians, the choir, the Bell Choir, the Kentucky Brass, as well as those who led them, Noel and Harrison and Mark and others. And so would you join me in just showing our appreciation to them? We are so grateful. My guess is you will want to stick around for the postlude as well that the Kentucky Brass are playing for. But as you go today, would you receive this benediction? May the love of God the Father, the grace of Jesus Christ his Son, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, both now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you. Have a great Sunday.